thank you for doing this at this rather attractive surroundings to do an interview.
It is a great place.
How do we measure the success of American and NATO engagement in the Balkans when you look at it today in terms of where we are and what's happened in the intervening years after Bosnia and after Kosovo?
I think you have to see it as a process. We stopped a war in 1995. We did it with the pledge of 25,000 American troops and some great diplomacy led by Richard Holbrooke. We worked on the ground for 2.5 years from that point on to try to get the Dayton Agreement implemented. Milosevic pulled his next rabbit out of the hat, looking for trouble in Kosovo. We used threat to postpone his ethnic cleansing and then used an air campaign. We stopped it. All NATO's conditions were met in the ending of the air campaign. We put our troops in. We got 1.5 million people back to their homes there. We reduced the levels of violence in the country. And now we're in there on the ground. We're in the next phase of the process. We've got to get to a final status determination for Kosovo. What are we going to do with this country? Milosevic is out of power. Democratization's underway in Belgrade. It's going to be an arduous process. They've got a decade of catching up to do with other countries in Eastern Europe, and worse than a decade, they've got to rebuild much of what was lost by Milosevic and his cronies. And they're the keystone in the Balkans. But in the meantime, we've got to worry about the Kosovar Albanians. We've got to think about Montenegro, which may go its own way. So I think it's a process. But we're there, we're engaged. We've certainly got the military wherewithal to do what needs to be done. But, you know, it's fundamentally a political and diplomatic problem.
How long will American troops be there?
Well, we ought to be there until the work's done. But the majority of the work cannot be done by the military. We're in the phase of this operation where the political leaders and the diplomats have to take charge. We've got heavy-duty political lifting to be done. We've got to get the right course. We've got to help these societies rebuild. Macedonia needs help. Montenegro's got to make a choice to go its own way or not. If it makes its choice to go its own way and that's its decision, then it's got to be helped. Serbia has got to come back and be part of the West. Those are not things the military can do. The military's done its work. It's there. It's generally holding the peace together. You know, a lot of the fighting around the borders of Kosovo today is a direct result of the international community's reluctance to move toward a determination of final status of Kosovo. Will it be independent? Will it be autonomous? Are we going to have province-wide elections? And if so, when? And why haven't we had them before now?
But who should be exercising leadership to make that happen?
Well, I think it goes back to the heads of nations, because it's not something that can be done exclusively by NATO. NATO's there to lead the military. You're talking about a process that begins and, in some respects, ends in the United Nations and the Security Council, and then in the taskings and leadership given to the international diplomatic leaders and the diplomatic community in the states, in the Balkans. So it's fundamentally a political and diplomatic process.
Did we redefine a mission for NATO that might have consequences for the future?
Well, I hope so, because the old NATO was a Cold War organization. It was designed to protect the territory of states from an invasion across border. I don't think there's a threat of that in Europe today, but there is a threat to stability in Europe today. We saw that threat in the Balkans. We had 250,000 people killed, 2 million made homeless. Our campaign stopped the ethnic cleansing campaign that would have ultimately driven 1.5 million people out as refugees into the Balkans. All that's stopped. NATO had an important role in that. There are still other challenges in the region. NATO's the organization that's best suited to handle these challenges. But they're not purely military challenges. They're political military challenges. They require political leadership first.
And the expansion of NATO, where do you come down having your experience?
I think how wide
should be the expansion?
Well, Charlie, I think the promise of membership in NATO is one of the greatest positive forces afoot in Europe today. From the north to the south in Eastern Europe, nations want the stability, the security, the pledge that NATO members give each other, that an attack on one will be an attack for all. That's been a zone, an historic zone of instability, in part because the Soviet Union enjoyed having weak states on its western periphery. It encouraged the instability there. It kept them weak. It kept them dependent. This is a chance to right that wrong. These countries want to be aligned with the West. They're culturally with the West. They're democratic. They have a right to choose. I'm confident that NATO is going to determine that it will enlarge, that it's no threat to Russia, and these countries will eventually become NATO members.
But whether it's a threat to Russia or not, the Russians think it is.
Well, you know, some Russians think it is. I think if you really get down and talk seriously with Russians one-on-one, as I have done,
with military leaders,
they can't quite see it as a real threat. If you go up and say, now look, now how many divisions does NATO really have? And you're telling me that one or two NATO divisions is a threat to Russia? I mean, let's get real on this. Now, you may not like it because it may remind you that the Warsaw Pact dissolved at the end of the Cold War, that the Soviet Union fell apart, and that NATO remained. But let's all move into the future together. We've got to build a new Europe, a new Euro-Atlantic community. We want Russia to be part of that community. But you can't build it if Russia's nations are insecure.
So what do you make then of Putin in Iran talking about cooperation that might even involve the transfer of arms and the selling of arms?
Oh, I think it does involve the transfer of arms. Russia's desperately in need of money, and that's a big source of hard currency.
You think it's more about money than it is about, in a sense, flexing Russian muscle to say we're alive and well?
I think it's both. But if you want to reestablish Russian stability internally, you've got to put people to work. The arms factories do that. And not only that, but he can then go out to Ukraine and say, look here, you've got a lot of arms factories too. Now, if you come in and team up with me, we can sell these weapons in the Middle East. You get a lot of money. You get a lot of people back to work. This was the model of the Soviet Union. But it also gives Russia leverage and linkage. And there's no doubt that there are many in Russia who feel very, very badly about their loss of empire and their loss of relative prestige in the world. Yes, they've got their missiles, but that's all. They want to be back up there. They want respect. They want stability. And they have a different conception of security than we do. They feel historically more insecure than
always
we do. It's a function of their culture. They have fought on the periphery of Mother Russia now for two centuries. They've been fighting in the Caucasus for two centuries. If you're in the Caucasus, you'd view it as Russian imperialism. If you're a Russian, you'd view it as, well, it's necessary for security. And this is what the debate's about. So we're going to have to work with these Russian perceptions. But we're going to have to do it by convincing the Russians that they can't find security by making others insecure.
At the same time that NATO has shown a new mission, possibility of expansion, a redefinition of role, the Europeans, in the person of the European Union, are talking about creating a military force. Is that counterproductive?
Well, I think anything that helps the Europeans contribute more to the common security and defense of the Euro-Atlantic region is useful, important, and in fact, imperative. It's a political imperative on both sides of the Atlantic that the Europeans do more. Every nation in NATO took a cut in its defense. We did too. But the Europeans have cut a little bit more, and we'd like them to do more for themselves. If it takes the European Union rhetoric to do it, that's fine. Can I just say,
sure,
we have to be very careful here that we don't get carried away with the rhetoric. The Europeans have said that NATO remains the fundamental institution for Euro-Atlantic security. If that's the case, then we're in good shape.
Did the fight in NATO, did the NATO effort in the Kosovo War open European eyes to where they stood defensively? Did it give them some sense of feeling we're really far behind the Americans in terms of where we are?
Well, maybe a little, but more it opened their eyes politically. Many Europeans didn't really appreciate the fact that it took the American leadership to bring peace in Bosnia. Then in the Kosovo Air Campaign, it was American leadership, not just American technology, but American leadership that set the strategy and really brought the conflict to a conclusion. And there were things that we didn't want to do, the United States, that the Europeans did. For example, the Europeans were far more willing to talk about ground forces early on than the Americans were. I know there was a lot of talk in the American circles that it was the Europeans who wouldn't agree to it. But the honest truth is, as the Europeans came to me, it was the Americans who didn't want to do it and used the Europeans as an excuse.
Because President Clinton thought it was not, you know, that it would go against the political will of where America was. I mean, they didn't want to even raise it early on.
Every country in NATO, every country in NATO had domestic political problems with the Kosovo air campaign. But the art of alliance leadership is to build on common interests. And so this playing off one country against your domestic political interests, as we did, really hurt America in Europe. And it, as much as anything else, the politics, not the military, the politics of this gave a strong impetus to the European Union's rapid reaction force.
Yet today, we see France, in the presence of Jacques Chirac, enormously critical of a missile defense plan.
Well, there's no doubt about it. They see it as, they're critical of it for three reasons. Number one is that if everybody really had missile defenses like that, then France's small force would be insignificant. Secondly, they see it as a U.S.-imposed by America technology program that they are likely to be excluded from. And third, we haven't really given them yet a convincing explanation for what strategic stability will look like in a world in which there are several nuclear powers, and many of these nuclear powers have missile defenses that will defeat smaller nuclear powers.
Where do you come down on this battle, on this debate about a missile defense system?
Well, I'd like to see the technology proved, but I think the technology's getting there, and I think it's going to be very, very hard for any American president to say that he won't, in principle, move forward with a defense, that he'd prefer to leave the American people vulnerable to a rogue nation, to a stray missile launch, an accidental missile launch, rather than move forward when the technology permits it. There are a lot of challenges. It's expensive, it's technically difficult, and there's an enormous communications problem that we've got to face.
And sanctions. General Powell has been talking about sanctions against Iraq and whether they are smart sanctions and what the consequences. Is he right?
Well, we've always known that the support for the kinds of sanctions we have today, the more complete sanctions, were going to erode. The question was, how long could we sustain them? Well, we did pretty well. We sustained them for a decade. And we said, when we lose that support, then we'll get a smaller, tighter group of sanctions. We'll sanction his military equipment, his dual-use industrial equipment, and we'll give him greater access if we have to. And that's where we're going. It's a slow movement, and maybe we can get better sanctions. But, you know, I think the key to this is the inspections on the ground. And I hope that we'll hang tough on insisting on an inspection regime on the ground in Iraq that will help us go back after
these. Before we change the sanctions.
Yes, I hope we will.
Do you believe sanctions work?
I'm not a great believer in economic sanctions. I've seen a lot of bad results in Haiti and in the Balkans.
Because they don't influence the actions of dictators and despots, or because the consequences for innocent people are too severe?
Well, both. They don't influence despots' actions because normally for a small group there are ways to circumvent economic sanctions, and they wreck the ordinary people in the country. So I know we want to do this, and maybe it is more humane to do that than go to war, but I think the 1990s show the destructive potential of sanctions. They can be very destructive.
Europeans and those people beyond our borders who you talk to in a variety of military roles, the most recent being Supreme Allied Commander, want what from the United States in terms of leadership? Do they want us, as George Bush says, to be more humble and to listen? Do they want us to exercise more leadership and to be out front and be the world's policeman?
Well, I think that,
or speak
like
loud,
everyone,
speak softly and carry a big stick.
There's ambivalence there. First of all, they greatly admire the values and the systems that America has enjoyed for 200 years. They admire our constitutional democracy. They would like us to respect them. They'd like us to support them and their choices. Occasionally, they'll ask us to assist them, especially if we're offering advice to them on how to do it. And on rare occasions, they may actually want us to take the first step and lead. And when we do, we have to understand that if you're going to lead, you have to share in the burdens and the risks of the operation. You can't lead from the rear. You can't push nations. You've got to be there with them. And that's why the role of American ground forces in Europe or in other places is so vital. Our allies don't buy the notion of a division of labor. It's true they don't have stealth fighters, and it's true they don't have all the satellite reconnaissance. But they are willing to risk their young men and women. And if we're going to get those benefits, then we have to be prepared to take commensurate risks. If we're going to lead, we have to be there with them, sharing the burdens.
Military strategy. Now that you're leaving the military for private life, going back to Little Rock, after a remarkable military career, number one in your class at West Point, a Rhodes Scholar, some extraordinary post along the way, you retire from the military. How hard a decision was that first for you personally?
Well, it wasn't a decision I made. It was a decision that was made for me.
Because they did not?
I was basically told that I was going to leave command early. It wasn't a discussion, it wasn't a choice, a decision was made. So I made the best of it. After I was told that, I continued to work until the day I was replaced. I've loved the military and the men and women in uniform and their families that we've served with. We had a great career.
And dreamed of being chairman of the Joint Chiefs?
No, I never had any great dreams of any specific position. I think if you're going to succeed in any organization, whether it's the military or professional life, you have to like what you do. And you have to like the people you do it with. And you have to be, at least for me, I have to be caught up intellectually and emotionally in what I'm doing. It's not about ambition. It's not about a place. It's about the substance of what you're doing. I happen to believe in the work that we were doing during the Cold War. And I was fortunate enough to have some great opportunities at the National Training Center to help influence our doctrine and training. And I love that. And during the post-Cold War, I was able to work with Richard Holbrooke and got to see firsthand the problems in the Balkans and have some impact on that. I watched as our military grappled with the problems of transformation from a Cold War military to a post-Cold War military. Of course, that's not done yet. That's a huge challenge we've got to face. And I'm disappointed that I won't be there in uniform to help us face those challenges. But I'll do what I can from the outside.
Why did they make that decision?
You know, I honestly don't know the answer and probably never will. I don't know.
You don't know?
I don't know.
Who made the decision?
It was made by my superiors in the U.S. chain of command, the Secretary of Defense, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff.
Do you think they would have made that decision without the concurrence of the President?
I think the President concurred in the decision, but I don't think he concurred knowing how the decision was going to be announced and what the consequences would be. I don't think he had full knowledge of the alternatives. But that's the way it is. I knew from the time I took that position in NATO that there was going to be tension with the Pentagon. I was really serving two masters. I was trying to make the NATO mission a success in the Balkans. And at the same time, I was trying to reduce the size of the mission and comply with the wishes of the Secretary of Defense to get us out of the Balkans. And we tried to do both, but ultimately, and we were succeeding in Bosnia, but when it came to Kosovo, it was clear that if the United States didn't take the lead, that we were going to have another, even worse situation of ethnic cleansing as Milosevic used his forces against Kosovo. And so I had to work inside U.S. channels, which I tried to do as respectfully and in all the administrative discipline that I could bring to bear on it to help shape U.S. policy. And I know there were frictions as a result.
What's your feeling about your commander-in-chief at the time?
Well, I think his heart was in the right place. The Balkans were his most important foreign policy achievement. He wanted to make it a success. He wanted us to succeed. He wanted us to defeat Milosevic's ethnic cleansing in Bosnia and in Kosovo. And under his leadership, we did.
Is his presidency a tragedy because of what might have been?
Well, I don't think it's really appropriate for me to address the whole presidency, Charlie, because I can't see it all. I can tell you in the parts that I saw that I wish he could have done more during the time he was president.
Distracted by other, because
think,
he didn't have the
I
will
think,
and didn't have the will to take the political risk, or because he was distracted by
Well, I think there were a number of factors. One of those was it was a rough start, especially in foreign affairs.
Because of gays in the military or because of...
It was a function of his relationship with the military, the gays in the military issue, but also he got dealt a very tough hand in foreign policy. This tends to happen to presidents, whether they're Democrats or Republicans.
You had some questions about where America should be engaged, you know, and you had some questions as to choices, but an attitude and mindset. And you had some distinctions and delineations as to whether Bush would be less likely to engage American troops than Gore was. But this definition of where and how America leads the world and what our strategy is has not been articulated by either diplomats or military so far.
But it's not going to be articulated by the military. It's not their place to do so. Honestly, it's got to be articulated by the commander-in-chief. He has to have the vision, he has to work with Congress, and Congress has to support. You have to have a united executive and legislative branch consensus that keeps America engaged in the world, supporting our friends. That's what it's going to take to make the world safe for our values and our economy in the years ahead.
Thank you.
Thank you, Charlie.
Ted Waitt co-founded Gateway in an Iowa barn in 1985. Since then, the company has grown into one of the largest sellers of consumer PCs. Early last year, he stepped down as CEO to concentrate on long-term internet strategies for Gateway and his own foundation. During this year, away from the company, Gateway sales began to slip and the stock plummeted. In January, Ted Waitt reassumed the position of CEO, armed with a detailed turnaround plan. He faces a number of challenges in returning Gateway to profitability, including a softening in the PC market and a general slide in the economy. I'm pleased to have him back on this program. Welcome back.
Good to be here, Charlie.
Here's what I want to know first. You left because what?
Well, I set a goal for myself. You know, myself and Mike Hammond, we had a deal. We founded the company in 1985.
Right.
The original name of the company was Gateway 2000.
Right.
We're going to work up into the year 2000. We're going to be done. Right. I honored the deal, Mike Hammond Welch, because he kept on working. So it was just a long-term goal. I planned a succession. I became just chairman
okay.
in the year 2000.
Do you have any regret about turning down the offer from Compaq, which would have made you an even richer man, probably, at
no,
the time?
No. I have no regrets. I'm such a fortunate guy, Charlie. I have no regrets about it.
So anybody says you might have made a billion or two more here or whatever it might have been, you say, no, I'd rather have my company and take my chances.
Yeah, at that point, you know, it's wealth is relative at a certain point. It's mm-hmm. not all about the money.
You came back, why?
Well, it was the right thing to do. I mean, Jeff Weitzen, who was the CEO, made a decision to retire. I know the company, I love the company, I was chairman. You know, I got excited about the opportunity.
But you were worried about the company.
You know, I was, you know, being an active chairman, you know, involved in asking the questions that the board should ask in corporate governance, but I wasn't looking to get back into the company.
What did you do during your time off?
I had a great year, you know. I mean, I took a year off. I spent a little more time with my kids. Did a lot of little things. I was on some boards. Got involved in our foundation, did
right.
some investing, found out that I'm not a very good investor.
Yes.
I learned a lot.
True, a lot of entrepreneurs.
I learned a lot about myself. It was a year of exploration.
What'd you learn? I mean, that's a fascinating inquiry. I mean, what does one who has the opportunities you had to do anything learn when he's away?
Well, my dad always told me, he said, everybody needs one thing to do when they wake up in the morning. And I never realized really what he meant until I guess I was out of it for a year.
Yeah.
You know, I'm kind of wired where, You know, I can have balance with my family, my wife and children. But I like to do that one thing. I love running a business. I love working with a group of people that I like to be around. I like to make things happen, see the difference. It's a lot of fun, especially when you're doing it for the right reasons.
The right reasons meaning what?
Meaning doing the right things for our customers, doing the right things for our employees. You know, at this point, I've been fortunate enough in my life where it's not about the money for me.
Yeah. Did you come back as a different man in any way in terms of how you want to run a company, what you want the company to stand for, or is it simply maximizing customer satisfaction and gateway profitability?
What we're talking about now is really getting the company back to basics. I mean, that's what the company was all about. It was about customer satisfaction, doing the right thing for employees, the customer experience, the employee experience, delivering a higher quality product at a better price with better service and support, and being maniacally focused on the customer satisfaction. Nobody in our business does a great job there, and we want to do a great job. You know, it's a little bit of the old and a lot of the new. You know, I think I'm in a position now where a few years ago I don't think I could do the job the way I can do it today. I've learned a lot by looking at a lot of other companies, taking a little time off, learned a lot about myself and how to run a business, and I'm doing things in a different way than I did them in the past.
And your faith in the PC, because when you built Gateway, the PC growth was just like this.
Right.
It doesn't look that way now.
Yeah.
Because of handheld devices, lots of other ways to compute, lots of other ways to access the internet.
Mm-hmm. I don't necessarily see other ways to access the internet impacting the purchase of PCs right now. Most of the really successful devices, you know, like you know, we both have Blackberries.
Yeah, right. Blackberry that I threw out of the room.
These types of devices, most of them are an extension of the PC, right. Not necessarily a replacement of the PC. I mean, I think what's happening to the PC market is, you know, people haven't had a compelling reason to upgrade. And, you know, there's some economic issues in this industry where, there's two reasons. People don't think they need a PC if they don't have one,
right.
Or they can't afford one. You know, we need to do a better job delivering value to those customers, making things more affordable, showing people what they can do with a PC that they didn't know they didn't know they could do, and giving people a compelling reason to get an additional PC. You see a lot of contention still for PCs in the household. You know, people have one PC, multiple kids, everybody's
fighting. So what's the compelling reason?
There's some more compelling reasons coming. There's things that people can do with PCs. You know that. They didn't necessarily know they could do.
I mean,
a tremendous number of people right now are downloading music off the internet. It's a very big application. Napster's out there doing their thing. That's a good application.
All right. Here's what interests me, and I'm going to help me understand this. How do you see everybody in the area, the businesses that you're in, and they talk about wireless, they talk about the internet. And they talk about some talk about voice recognition, a whole lot of other things. I mean, give me a sense of where you think the excitement of the future is, in terms of the world of technology, and in terms of the kinds of products that you might manufacture to fit that world.
Well, I mean, if you look at we're in kind of an uncertain economic time right now. You know, the products that excite me is our capability to deliver solutions to customers. You know, people out there, well, there's a lot of two-income families, they have kids, they're running around, they go to soccer games on weekends, they work like fiends during the week. Technology has the ability and the promise to save people time. You know, I don't think we've really reaped the benefits of productivity from technology. Now, you talk about it now, we have email, we have, you know, fax machines, we have cell phones, right? And do these things really make things simpler, or are they just all additive, where we're busier and more hectic than we used to be? Now, if technology is truly to realize its promise, it should save people time, it should save people money, allow them to spend more time with their family, have more money that they can spend on other things other than just technology, because the internet enables people to do better comparison shopping and actually get out, save some money. It enables people to do education and learn things about themselves, learn things about the world that exists out there, get in touch with people in ways they couldn't do before. What has happened, though, is it can't be just for the sake of technology. If people have to, and in this industry, look at what people want to do and make their lives easier through technology, rather than just do it for the sake of technology.
What's your relationship with AOL?
Our relationship with AOL is, you know, we provide AOL access. We bundle it in our systems.
So it's like a one-touch system now.
What do you mean?
I mean, you can access almost automatically. You can access AOL.
Yes. Yeah.
It comes bundled
in from a gateway system. You get a year of
in the same
AOL.
Way.
You get a year of AOL included with the purchase of a gateway system. We work closely with AOL to try and deliver the best value in that marketplace.
And what does that do for you? I mean, how important is that to your future?
I mean, it's important. We're the only people that can offer a full year of internet access. Gateway was the first PC company to bundle internet access with our PCs. We were the first company to become an ISP with gateway.net.
Right.
It's all part of delivering the solution to people. So they, you know, buy a PC, then I got to go to somebody else for my internet access. Hey, I just want to get on the internet, make it easy for me, give me everything in one stop. So it enabled us to do a better job of that.
Mm. Essential to your success has been direct selling of computers,
mm-hmm.
right? Same thing is true for Dell.
Yep.
Is that essential to your future?
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, one of the things that I've done in the last few weeks is eliminate virtually all of the activities that were not about the direct relationship with our customers. That is so core to our long-term success is that direct relationship with consumers, that direct relationship with small businesses, helping them do things they couldn't do before. That's what it was about. That's how we can develop true value for our customers and develop a long-term earnings growth-based company.
Let me turn to something you're interested in and you've talked about as well, the digital divide.
Mm-hmm.
Your foundation, part of the time you spent away was to sort of, I assume, to look at that and have more time to look at it. How do we get at this issue of who has access to computers and who has access to the internet so that it doesn't become more of have than have nots?
It's a really complicated issue. I mean, the more we've looked at it, the more complex the issue really is. Now we're fighting, you know, one of the symptoms of the digital divide. And the digital divide in and of itself is a symptom of a whole bunch of other problems, economic problems, and a whole other host of issues in society. Why I got involved with it is I was really concerned about creating the haves and the have-nots of really, because technology enables people to move forward, enables them to learn more, to do more things. That's why I got involved with it. You know, we've built in the last year or so, we rolled out about 300 of these power-up centers with Gateway Computers, sponsored by my foundation. We're going to build another 500 this year. And really, it's just kind of the tip of the iceberg. I mean, it really is the tip of the iceberg. Long-term, you want to make them affordable so people can get them in their homes, so everybody's on a level playing field, and it's a difficult problem to solve.
People have been talking about affordability and simplification
mm-hmm.
over the last 10 to 12 years, it seems to me, for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, simplification was the buzzword for a couple of years there. Why haven't we had more progress on that front? Why aren't there very good $500 computers?
There's a lot of things involved. I mean, one is, you know, technology keeps going up.
Yeah.
At the same time, the demands keep going up. Now, the prices have come down. I mean, we can offer tremendous power for a very low price today. You know, I mean, like a system for $1,000 that has gigabytes of storage,
right.
You know, which stores thousands and thousands of songs. You can store movies on it. I mean, you can do everything with this product. But what we haven't done is really said, how do people want to use this? How do we make it easier to use?
Yeah.
And it's a difficult issue.
And how do you get around it? I mean, it's a crucial issue, isn't it? In terms of being able to reach a broader population, is both cost and simplification.
Right.
So how do you get at simplification? Isn't that your responsibility and
R&D? It's definitely our responsibility. I mean, one of the things we've done just recently is dramatically simplify our product line. We don't think everybody needs. We had 23 million different computers that we could sell.
Yeah.
And now we've taken it down to about 400 or 500 in the consumer market, and about 600 for small businesses. And I think we can still take it to the next level by offering plenty of choice for people, so we can simplify the hardware, but what we really need to do is simplify the whole experience, and that takes a combination of hardware and software. One of the things we want to do is work very closely with Microsoft. There's some new operating systems coming out. They've talked about, you know, Whistler, Windows XP, which I think has a tremendous promise to make PCs actually more reliable, more robust, and easier to use. So we want to work closely with them to see if that's rolled out in the right way.
Microsoft has a good future, doesn't it?
I think they do. I mean, Microsoft's a great company. I mean, they clearly have
a lot of cash,
and they have a dominant position in the industry.
Yeah.
If you look at what they've done, they made so much money on their core products, and they've actually lost a lot of money on some other initiatives. So I think in the uncertain economic times that we're in right now, these things can be good for a lot of companies. You know, what you're going to see is, you know, the rising tide kind of lifted all boats for a while, and now the sinking tide is kind of dropping all boats, and you're going to see the cream rising to the top.
Have you noticed a change in their attitude in terms of the relationship that they have with people like you who make PCs?
I haven't noticed a significant change in the relationship. Now, our personal relationship with Microsoft, we're working on making that a better relationship. I was just talking to them.
Just explain that
Microsoft
to me.
Microsoft is Microsoft. They're a great
they
company.
They didn't change at all, huh?
I mean,
they still play hardball.
They're still a very driven and focused
Steve
company.
Steve is not a teddy bear that just wants to be
cuddly. Steve's a nice guy.
But you would assume and that all this has had a chastening kind of effect on them, and that they believe that they can do well and do good at the same time.
Yeah, I think they've definitely gone through some of their own soul searching.
Yeah, but is it reflected in their relationship with people like you who are PC manufacturers?
Yeah, you know, I'm 6 weeks back on the job.
We don't know that.
It's a little early yet to tell, Charlie. I certainly would hope so.
But there are no indications you've seen so far.
Well, I think the proof is going to be in the Windows XP rollout.
Okay, there you go.
That's what it really is going to prove this time.
What do I expect with the XP rollout? Yeah.
What I expect from XP is some flexibility for us to be able to deliver a better experience to consumers. I think they have done the early indications of they've done a great job with XP in terms of, you know, it's based on that Windows NT kernel.
Right.
So it's much more reliable. You know, it'll prevent a lot of the problems. It allows us for once to kind of get rid of this huge complexity of this legacy. I think we really have a huge opportunity to make things just so they interconnect better, so everything works better together. So the software works better, the hardware devices, when you plug them in, they work, so everything just works better. There's a tremendous opportunity to do that.
Beyond all that stuff that was part of the antitrust trial, including the browser, but also the fact that they own such a high percentage of the operating system market, can you argue also that the fact that they did gave a certain stability and a certain standardization that was crucial?
Yeah, I mean, you can definitely make that point. I mean, that Microsoft...
But do you buy it, is my question.
No, but you can't. I mean, Microsoft, you know, without a standardized operating system, you know, this market wouldn't be here. Without standards, it wouldn't exist. So, I mean, you can...
They help contribute to that, obviously, with owning that much of a market share with it.
Without a doubt. You know, if we were in a world where there was five different operating systems, you know, the market probably wouldn't have grown like it would have, but... Again, then there would be some competition for the user.
And there would have been some innovations that we might not have seen.
Maybe.
That perhaps we didn't see.
Maybe.
When you talk about a beyond-the-box strategy, what do you mean?
That means to us is our ability to deliver all the solutions around the box rather than just the box itself. You know, if I put a PC right here all by itself, it doesn't really do anything for you.
Right.
Unless that PC, you can connect to the internet easily.
Right.
Unless... If you need financing, we have that available.
Right.
If you need some training, we have that available.
You still do those little schools?
Yeah, we still do schools. We have training centers in almost each of our country stores. If you want that product installed in your house for you, we should be able to do that as well. If you want when that person installs to give you a quick tutorial, we should be able to do that. If it breaks, you want somebody to come fix it, we should be able to do that. If you want to take it back to a store, we should be able to do that. You know, it's everything around the box. If you want to do digital photography, right, and you don't know how to do that, I want to do digital photography. I want to take pictures of my kids and email them out to my grandparents. How do I do that? Well, here's a camera, here's a software package, and we'll send you to a training class so you can do all that. We'll tie it all into one solution package.
Gateway Stores was a good idea or a bad idea?
I think Gateway Stores was a great idea. Time will tell, for sure. But I think, of course, it was my idea. I have to say that. But I think it is definitely our competitive advantage. If the Gateway stores were operating at a level that they were in 1997, when we had 30 stores, people would know, you know, the Gateway was a force to be reckoned with, because we'd be far and away the number one consumer PC seller in the marketplace, and also be doing the same thing in small business. What we haven't done a good job of is making people aware of our stores. You know, consumers aren't aware of them. 90%+ of people out there are aware of Gateway as a brand, and only 30% approximately are aware that we have stores. and even fewer know where that store is.
Well, and even fewer know what those stores do.
And fewer know what they do. You know, so if people just walked into one of our stores, they would see how different of a buying experience it is, and what we can do that, you know, our competition, whether it be Best Buy, Circuit City, can't do. You just need to walk into one.
You're a happier man because you're back at work.
Yeah.
Great to have you.
Thanks, sir.
Ted Waitt, the man who started Gateway and was now back running the company. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Jake Steinfeld is the CEO of Body by Jake Enterprises. In the 1980s, he made a name for himself as the trainer to the stars in Hollywood. Capitalizing on his success, he expanded his company to include workout equipment, videotapes, a fitness television network, books, and a magazine. He's even started his own sitcom on the Family Channel. He is perhaps best known for his infomercials, which earned him an award for Best Infomercial in 1995. These days, he has embarked on a new endeavor to bring the sport of lacrosse to the professional arena with the launch of Major League Lacrosse. I am pleased to have him here on this program. Welcome, my friend.
Job, good to see you,
great
buddy.
Great to see you.
Very well done. I like that. It was a nice little bio.
We need all the praise. Listen, now, why are you in lacrosse?
Well, this is a game that I played in high school. Yeah. You know, I was born in Brooklyn, New York. I was raised in Baldwin, Long Island.
Yeah.
Played the game in high school. Got into college because I played the game. Went upstate New York to a school called Cortland State. I was pretty good. Wasn't that great. I was a good face-off guy. So I played winter lacrosse.
Right.
And as a face-off guy, I would start the game off. And then I played on the fourth midfield. So my story goes, we were scrimmaging against Syracuse in the snow in March. And after I faced off, which I'm sure I had won that face-off, and came off on the sideline, played on the fourth midfield. And standing on the sideline like a lacrosse ice sculpture, I said to myself, what am I doing? There's no such thing as professional outdoor lacrosse. I'm going to go to California to pursue bodybuilding, which is exactly what I did. And thank goodness I did that, because I was a lot better at bodybuilding than I ever was at the game. Yeah. But I always kept the love of the game with me throughout the years. And I would, you know, see an occasional game. I've been living in Los Angeles now for some 23 years. Just turned 43 2 weeks ago. So it's I've been there longer than I've been in New York, actually. Mm-hmm. And I'd watch the occasional game and would witness their two cameras locked off in an end zone. And I would say, I don't understand. This game is such a great game. American sports fans love hitting, scoring, and speed. This game has it all. And then I flipped the channel, you know. 3 years ago, I was interested in getting into the sports business. I've been very fortunate in the fitness business, as you mentioned, doing infomercials and the television network and all. And I was going to buy into a minor league baseball team. You know, I mean, jock's dream is to get into the sports business. And as an entrepreneur, you always want to be in control of your own destiny, or as best as you can. And what I started to feel and see is that Jake Steinfeld wasn't going to change the face of Major League Baseball anytime shortly, nor did anyone really care. And I said, okay, so as I was putting that aside, I did a short-lived magazine with the folks at Hachette Filipaki. And during my tenure there, John Kennedy was doing George, and a kid named David Lauren was doing a magazine called Swing. Right. And the three of us would go on the road and sell to advertisers. We went to Detroit together and sell to car companies, and we'd all see each other's books. And David Lauren did this magazine called Swing, which is, in essence, what kids did in their 20s. And I took a copy on the plane with me and read an article about this guy who started a company called Warrior Lacrosse. And his story, his name is Dave Morrow, grew up in Detroit as a hockey player. A teacher turned him into a lacrosse player, went to Princeton, became an All-American. That was all well and good. But it's what he did with his company. He sort of turned the lacrosse world on its head. And it reminded me of like a young Phil Knight. And I said, man, this guy is doing something serious with this sport. I picked up the phone and called him. I asked him two questions. Is there such a thing as professional outdoor lacrosse? And is there a governing body for the game? He said, no. I go, well, there is now. And
Jake is on the scene.
Jake is on the scene. And, you know, we did it slowly.
Yeah.
Last summer, we launched a summer showcase to test it. You know, like in Hollywood, you do a, you know, you get a 6-episode pickup for a show.
Right.
We basically gave it a 6-episode pickup.
So what does that mean?
We played in six markets.
Right.
We took the top 40 players in the world, and we tested this. Our business plan called for 5,000 fans, not 90,000 fans. The difference that I believe in why we're going to succeed is that in this startup league, we have the top players in the world playing in Major League Lacrosse. You can't really say that for many other startups. Yes, there's going to be a lot of fanfare and fan zones and halftime shows. At the end of the day, the fan wants a great game. And that's what we were able to give them last summer. And then as a single entity ownership, where in essence the league owns the teams, you need to find people. It's not just money. Find people that get along, because we wanted to launch in 6 markets. Good small test. Grow it from there. And this summer we're launching in Rochester, New York, Long Island, Baltimore, Boston, New Jersey, and Connecticut.
Now here's what I would assume you'd need. A television contract.
Good. Very good.
Very good, Charles.
That's one down and three. We do have a television contract with Fox Sport Net that they're going to air.
This is the regional?
This is the national Fox Sport Net that they're going to air 5 of our national games, our inaugural game, All-Star game, and our championship weekend. Yeah. And all the Fox regionals are going to air all the local games.
Now, are you ready for this? Have you got this league set up? Is it organized? You got the best players? You got the right uniforms? You ready to promote the sport? Because you can't, in the end, just depend on lacrosse aficionados, can you?
Absolutely not.
You got to spread the game. You got to make the game more popular. You got to do what American basketball has done with basketball around the world.
We need to create stars first and foremost.
Right.
And the way you go about doing that, obviously, is through television exposure. There is a core audience, but you need to build from that. And the core audience, obviously, is in our Northeast regions. But the game is the fastest growing game in the country. And to go back
to the
question,
why?
Fastest growing game in the country.
And how do we measure that?
Because I'm telling you.
Yeah, that's what I was afraid of.
Wasn't that believable?
Exactly. That's what I thought.
What am I going to say? You know?
Jesus Christ. Oh, my God.
No, I mean through sales
and
different
things. It's the fastest growing sport in America in your mind.
Well, that's where it has to start. You know what I mean? In order to succeed in life, the world lets you be what you make them believe you
exactly.
are.
Exactly. That's right. First, you got to believe, and then
it
will be.
And then you will achieve. You know? But I saw a great opportunity here.
So now we're out in Hollywood, and we're doing all this stuff, and we're doing all the things that I talked about in the introduction. And you got all these new friends who are some of the elite of Hollywood, right? From Spielberg to Harrison Ford and Warren Beatty and Bette Midler and Priscilla Presley.
Right.
Now, who was the young woman who recommended you in the first place?
Her name was Sandy Will. She became Sandy Carradine, married Keith Carradine. And she's still a friend and just a terrific
lady. We owe her
lady.
Big time, don't we?
Yeah. We do. And she always tells me that.
Exactly. I remind you.
Where's my 10%?
Yeah. So you go on to make a lot of money and get different kinds of things. But you live with this lacrosse thing, or did you come back to it for some reason?
I came back to it. It was a complete, Charlie, I have to tell you, this was something that I loved, but not a passion to where I said one day, you know. The fitness business has been very great to me, and it was a moment. I mean, it really was a moment. I sort of literally left this baseball idea just because I wanted to get into something new, something interesting, something different. And I literally opened up David Lauren's magazine called Swing on the plane, and I saw a guy with a lacrosse stick. I said, read this.
So Mr. Morrow is now one of your partners.
Yes, he sure is.
Now you guys, you and Morrow and Pat Robertson's son.
Tim Robertson,
own the...
Yes, we own the league.
What's it called?
Major League Lacrosse.
All right.
And it's a single entity ownership, so the 6 owners of the teams own a piece of the league as well. We are the founders, and there are 6 owners. So the league owns the teams.
Where does your confidence come? Why do you think you're going to be...
First and foremost, we have the best players in the world playing in this game. Big sports today, I think, there's an oversaturation. There's a loss of uniqueness. The American sports fan is always looking for something new and something different. Lacrosse is older than baseball. It's been around since before baseball.
Yeah.
Okay. That I know. That you can look up.
Another.
Charlie, you busted my chops here, man.
Another one. Jake.
Another Jakeism.
We can prove this.
I'll give you the rapid do on that one. But more importantly, the core of what we are doing is we have a great game, and in my mind, with a sound business plan, we're not saying that we're going to play in Giant Stadium tomorrow afternoon. We're playing in intimate stadiums.
Right.
Our business plan calls for 5,000 fans. We're playing predominantly, or we're playing in the Northeast, right, where the super hotbed is.
Right.
This game is growing.
Right.
And through television, through our sponsors like Anheuser-Busch, who I sort of call the sports legitimizer.
Right.
You know, when they get involved in something, they, it's like as an author. You know, you can do a television show, but when you write a book, for some reason, you are perceived as, in essence, legitimate.
Right.
And I look at Anheuser-Busch as the sports legitimizer, along
right,
with Sobe and the folks at Reebok and Yahoo Sports are our sponsors. But we have a good, solid business plan. We have a great game. We're playing in the summer. There's not a lot of competition on television.
A 14-game summer schedule that culminates in a 4-team playoff Labor Day weekend, an event Steinfeld hopes will recreate the atmosphere. It recreates the atmosphere. I mean, of the NCAA championship weekend traditionally held during the same holiday.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, you're looking at the Final Four as your model as to
That's exactly right.
Weekend where Major League Lacrosse comes to this stellar conclusion.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. We have a great game, and it's going to be a heck of a lot of fun.
I mean, we've
seen it this past summer, and it really works.
Yeah.
And I hope to see you there this summer.
Good for you.
Thanks,
great
buddy.
Great to have you.
Great to see you, man.
We'll watch for this. Jake is one of the founders of Major League Lacrosse, a sport that a lot of people have played. I know when I was at Duke, a lot of kids from the Northeast would come
right
down, and they all played lacrosse, and I think women play a lot of lacrosse now.
The women's game is huge, because the Title IX, it is a huge game.
All right. So there's an audience out there, people who play it and like lacrosse. We'll see as Jake tries to make Major League Lacrosse one more sports spot for American sports enthusiasts. Thank you for joining us. See you next time.
Students on the web
say they're getting better grades.
Are you ready?
Virtually all internet traffic travels across the systems of one company, Cisco Systems, empowering the internet generation.
Funding for Charlie Rose is made possible by Amazon.com, your online source for everything from books, music, and toys to videos, electronics, and tools.
Is also made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.